Hello children, today we are starting a new chapter, that is a sexual reproduction in flowering plants. As you know from previous chapter that this physiological process complete in three events. So it is same with this chapter also because we are talking about the flowering plant. So the same event that happen with any kind of organism during the sexual reproduction we will discuss in this chapter also. So, if we talk about the sexual reproduction in flowering plants, what is there? We are talking about the flowering plants. So, if we talk about flowering plants, means we are talking about the angiosperm plant, right? And angiosperm plant, the main part that participate in the process of this reproduction is the flower. So, before go to the process of this physiological process, what we have to know? We have to know the structure of a flower. So, you can see in this diagram, what is there? There are the four main parts of the flower. Out of four, two is known as the accessory part and two is known as the reproductive part, right? You know, I think from your previous studies also that accessory part is known as the calyx and corolla. In common, you used to say like sepals and petals. This is the sepals and this is the petals, right? If you see that, this is what this one is a this if we this is what this is your petals, right? This green portion is known as a sepal. This reproductive part, this main part is known as the carpel, and these are known as the stamen, right? So these are what, these are the main part of the flower. If we talk about the what is the important in these four parts, if in four parts each part is having their own responsibility, right? And if we talk about what is flower, what is flower, if you want to define, the flower is a modified condensed shoot that arise on the axile of a small leaf like structure that we call as a bract. You have seen from, I think in each stem there is a small leafy structure coming from the main stem that we call as the axile of the leaf, and from that there is a small green structure come out that we call as a bract, and from that portion there is a formation of a flower take place. So what is flower? Flower is a modified condensed shoot that is a main reproductive part of a plant, right? If you talk about the flower, again the flower is what? Flower is not a reproductive part. Along with that, it's a source of food. For example, if after the fertilization, what will happen? This flower change into the fruit, means a part of the flower change into the fruit. So it is a source of food also. So on the basis of that, flower is, on the basis of these four important parts, flower is two type. One is known as a complete and second one is known as an incomplete flowers. So what is the difference? Very simple difference is there. If all the four important parts of the flower is present, for example, sepal, petals, stamen and pistil. So if all these whorls are present in a flower, that flower is known as a complete flower. Or in contrast to, if a any one of them is lacking, that flower is known as an incomplete flower, right? And along among the all four whorls, two whorls is known as a vegetative part and two whorls is known as a reproductive part. So this is all about your structure of a flower. Now what happens in the structure, how the events take place, that we will study in the coming slide. Okay children, now listen carefully what I am trying to say. If we talk about the reproductive process in the flower, so you know very well it divided into three parts. First is known as a pre-fertilization, second one is a fertilization, and third one is a post-fertilization events. If you remember from your previous chapters, so pre-fertilization events is having a two part, that was a gamete formation and gamete transfer. So it means gametogenesis and gamete transfer. Same we will discuss in this chapter also, but we are just going to deal with the flower structure only. We are going to stick with the flower only. So during, how it happens, when the vegetative juvenile phase or vegetative phase of the plant is over, then there is a formation of a flower, right? During that there are the number of hormonal changes take place, and due to that there is a development of a male and female part of the flower. So male part is known as the androecium and female part is known as the gynoecium. you can say like this way also, stamen and carpal. But what is the difference between androecium and stamens? Number of times I have told you already. Again, I am saying it's very minute difference is there. If you talk about the androecium, androecium is means a whorl of stamens, a single part of the male reproductive organ is known as a stamen, and a whorl of stamen is known as the androecium. Same with the gynoecium also. Gynoecium represent actually the female reproductive organ that we call as a carpal, right? So a whorl of carpal is known as gynoecium. Same with the sepal and petals also, right? If you have heard this word sepal and petals, so we in the science we used to a different word for the sepal is the calyx. Listen carefully, it is not in this slide, but listen it very carefully what I am saying. I am saying sepal is a when we are talking about the sepal means we are talking about the individual appendages of the sepal. A group of sepal is known as calyx. Same with the corolla, a group of petal is known as corolla. So this is the difference between the these words, why we call stamen as androecium, why we call carpal as a gynoecium, why we are using another word for the sepal that is a calyx, why we are using another word for the corolla that is a petal. So these are the difference between these terms. Now come to the main part of the flower, that is the reproductive part. If we talk about the reproductive part, means we are talking about the especially stamen and carpal, right? So stamen is what typical, if we talk about the typical stamen structure that we will see in the coming slide, stamen is having a two part. One is known as the anther and second one is a long filamentous structure that we call as a filament, right? And each anther is having a two lobe that we call as a bilobe structure that you have studied in the previous class also. So on the basis, if the stamen or if the anther is having a two lobe, that anther is known as dithecus, right? And in that lobe there is a presence of a, each lobe is having a two microsporangia, means there is a, in totality how many microsporangia is there, that is a four microsporangia. And what common word we use for the microsporangia, actually microsporangia is a sac in that pollen grains are packed. So another word we use for the microsporangia is what, that is a pollen sac, and inside the pollen sac there is a pollen grains. So that is the structure of the stamen. Now you can see the detailed structure in the coming slide also. So what is that? If we talk about the gamete formation, actually what we are talking about, we are talking about the male gamete. First we will talk about the male gamete formation, then we will talk about the female gamete formation in the flower. So in case of male gametophyte, that we call a pollen grains. So what we have to know, we have to know how, where does the pollen grains present, how the formation of pollen grains take place, which part is responsible, what is the procedure, that we will see in this slide. So start with that development of the male gametophyte, or you can say pollen grains. So for that, what we have to know, we have to know actually the structure of a place from where these pollen grains formed. So it actually, which part, it actually the stamen, right? So stamen is what, stamen is a male reproductive organ that is having a two part that I have told you already, that is what, that is a filament and anther, right? Filament is what, filament is a long tube like structure, anther is a knob like structure. If you can see in this diagram, this is a knob like structure. In that there is a form, there is a presence of a each anther is having a two lobe, and that lobes are known as the microsporangia. Why we are using micro in case of this? Because in flowers we frequently use two words, micro and mega. Whenever we are talking about the micro, it means we are talking about the male reproductive part, and when we are talking about the female, that time we are using a mega gametophyte or mega sporangia like this, right? So this is what, this is a male gametophyte development. So the structure in that pollen grains are developed or formed, that structure is known as microsporangia, right? So here is the structure of anther, you can see over here. Right. So this is what, this is a typical stamen. This is a stamen. You can see here, stamen is a, this filament. This is the anther. It is connected by a connective tissue. Right. If you cut the transverse section, means from here, if you cut, so each lobe is having a two sac-like structure. You can see this. I am showing by a pointer also. There is, these are the lobes that we call as a microsporangia or the pollen sac. Right. Each pollen sac is responsible for the development of pollen grain. This means pollen grain formation take place where, inside this pollen sac. How this pollen grains formation take place, that we will discuss in coming slide. Okay, here what we will discuss the structure of microsporangia. So structure of microsporangia is what? A typical microsporangia is surrounded by four walls. Again, I am saying a typical microsporangia is having a four walls, right? And that wall, actually what is that, you can see in this diagram, it is having an epidermis followed by endodermis, or you can say endothecium, and followed by a third one layer, that is towards the inner side, that is a middle layer, and last layer is known as a tapetum. So among these four layers, epidermis, endothecium, middle layer and tapetum, among these four, three outer means epidermis, endothecium, middle layer, these are having a protective in nature, means these layers are protective in function, and what they do, actually they help in the breaking of anther to release pollen grains. So this is the main role of these three layers. But when we talk about the inner layer, means when we talk about this tapetum, this is the last layer of the microsporangium. So this is the innermost layer, nourish the developing microspores, means when there is a development of a microspores, or you can say pollen grain, so that time it helps in the nourishment of the microspores. And the cell, very unique thing is that the cell of the tapetum is having a dense cytoplasm and generally have a more than one nucleus. So there is a very interesting question, why the cell of the tapetum is having a more than one nucleus. Just find out the answer and tell me if you can find out. Otherwise, we will discuss in the assignment sheet what is the reason behind that, right? In this diagram also, you can see the three, four, all the layers very clearly. This is what, this is the epidermis, this is the endothecium, and followed by a middle layers, and last layer is known as the tapetum. So this is what, this is the structure of a microsporangium, right? So along with that, if we talk about the microsporangium is having these four layers, and inside these four layers there is a presence of tissues that we call as a sporogenous tissues, right? And these sporogenous tissue is actually start the formation of pollen grains. First cell from the sporogenous tissue behave as a pollen mother cell, PMC. Listen it very carefully. Again, I am repeating it. What is that? The each cell of the sporogenous tissue is a, actually what, it's a potential pollen mother cell, or you can say microspore mother cell. And they divide, and after the division, they give to what? They give to the structure that we call as a microspore tetraphase, right? And the formation of microspore means formation of the pollen grains from the pollen mother cell through the process of meiosis is known as microsporogenesis. So this is very important in this. So that we will see in the next slide, the diagram and flow of the microsporogenesis. So this is what, pollen grain development. This is a flow chart. By that you can see very clearly how the development of pollen take place, right? Now you see here, this is what, this is the anther, right? Anther is having a four lobes that we call as a microsporangia, right? And all the microsporangia covered by three layers. Inner layer is known as tapetum that provide nourishment. Inside the inner layer, last layer of the microsporangia, there is a presence of sporogenous tissue. As I told you earlier also, each sporogenous tissue is having a potential to behave as a microspore mother cell, right? So what happens, these microspore mother cells start dividing, right? Where inside the microsporangium. And after that meiosis, there is each microspore mother cell is capable to give rise a structure that we call as a microspore dirt trace, right? This is a microspore dirt trace. Like this structure, there is a thousand of microspore dirt trace present where inside this microsporangium. Now what happens, out of these four structure, three is going to be degenerate and just a single structure is present in this microspore and behave as a microspore, right? Microspore, you can say pollen grains. And these cell mature after three degeneration, the structure is known as a pollen grains. Now what happens if the process when the formation of a pollen grains take place from the pollen mother cell, so that process is known as microsporogenesis. Again, this is very important term. You should remember what is microsporogenesis. Now after that, what happened? There is a development of microspores take place. Now, what is microspores? Microspore is actually a male gametophyte, right? And it is what? It is a haploid, typically haploid, uninucleate and minute that present where inside the microspore mother cell. After the breaking of this anther, means when the microspores development take place inside the microsporangia, this anther wall is going to be break. And all the microspores come out and they start developing, right? When they start developing, they are going to be develop into a mature pollen grain structure like this. So what is that? The size, shape, color, design and of all pollen grains are not similar. It depends on species to species. It is going to be vary. But a general structure is saying what? It is having a outer covering, that covering, two layer covering is present. That two layer covering commonly we call it as a sporoderm. And out of two layer, outer hard covering is known as exine. And listen carefully, this exine is made up of a very hard substance that we call as a sporopollenin. Again, I repeat, it is made up of a hard substance that we call as a sporopollenin. It is a most known resistant organic material and it can survive in a very high temperature as well as in a strong acid and alkali. No enzyme means nothing can degrade it. So that's why pollens are well preserved as a fossil. It comes in your exam also, why pollens, why we are getting pollens as a fossil. So this is the reason behind that, because exine of the pollen is made up of most hard known substance that we call as a sporopollenin. After that exine, the inner layer is known as an entine. From the entine, this entine is not a continuous layer. It is having a prominent distal aperture for the germination. This is prominent distal aperture for the germination. So these are known as a germ pore. What we call them? We call them as a germ pore. And in that pose, there is an absence of sporopollenin. Sporopollenin is not present in germ pores. Now what is there? Each pollen grains is having a two cell structure. One is known as a generative cell and second one is known as a vegetative cell. So what is the difference between generative and vegetative cell? If you see the vegetative cells are very large. You can see in your book also, wherever you have downloaded the book, in that also you can see vegetative cells is larger. And why they are larger? Because they have an abundant reserve food material and a very large nucleus is present. They are irregular in shape. If on contrast, if we talk about the generative cell, these are very small in structure, spindle shape, and they float in the cytoplasm of the vegetative cell, means they are inside the vegetative cell. When the pollen grains are released from the anther, that time usually they are in this two cell stage, means they 60% of the angiosperm release or shed up from the anther at two cell stage. This is very important question again. And remaining species, means out of 140% species, जनरेटिव सेल अगेन डिवाइडेड एंड गिव राइज टू टू मेल गैमेट्स, राइट? तो इन 40% दे आर रिलीज इन अ थ्री सेल स्टेज, इन 60% पॉलन ग्रेन्स आर रिलीज एट टू सेल स्टेज. एंड देर इज अ वन इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग आई वॉन्ट टू मेंशन ओवर हेयर, there is a several species, several plants in that pollen grains may cause a severe allergy and bronchial infection leading to the asthma, bronchitis. A very common example you have seen in your neighbors or in the surrounding environment, a very common weed, I think you know weed, what is weed? Unwanted plant. So there is a very common plant is there that we call as a parthenium, or we call as a carrot grass that came to India as a contaminant with imported wheat, and now it is ubiquitous in all the places. Ubiquitous is a term we use for the species that can grow in anywhere, that we can find anything in anywhere. That time we use a one word that we call as a ubiquitous. So parthenium is one of the example of the ubiquitous species, and it is a severe cause of allergy for those who are having a asthma and bronchitis. So whenever what happens when the wind is blowing, that time the pollens release and they inhale by the air, and a person is affected severely with this. So this is the very unique thing in the pollen grains, some of the pollen grains. So they are responsible for the allergy also. Some of the pollen grains are very important for the nourishment also, because they are rich in nutrients. Number of tablets, number of syrups are making by the pollen grains, and they are used for to increase the performance of athletes and race horses. This is also a use of pollens. If you talk about the viability, means up to how long they can be live. So viability of pollens depend on the temperature and humidity. Listen children, this is not in this slide, but I am telling you, you should note it down somewhere what I am saying. So viability of pollen depends on temperature and humidity. It varies from species to species. If you talk about the wheat, so it is going to be viable. Wheat, if the pollens released from the wheat plant, it is going to be viable, or you can say it is going to be alive for 30 minutes. If we talk about the rice or some another member of the Solanaceae, Rosaceae or Leguminaceae family, so in that cases, pollen grains are alive up to a 1 month. So it depends on again species to species, the viability of pollen is also vary. If we want to store the pollen, pollen grains can be stored for years in a liquid nitrogen. Temperature minus 190 degrees Celsius is good for the storage of pollens in liquid nitrogen, and the preservation of pollen grains in liquid nitrogen at this temperature, we use a word for this process that is known as a cryopreservation. Again, I repeat, cryopreservation is one of the important terms that we use for the storage of pollen grains for a number of years in liquid nitrogen at 196 degrees Celsius. So this is very important, and the places where the pollen grains are stored, that places are known as pollen banks. So this is again very important, you should remember this. So this is a final flowchart for the development of the male gametophyte that we had discussed in this video. So what is this? In this flowchart, you can see this is the male reproductive organ. In male reproductive organ, main part is the anther. If we cut the transverse section of anther, we will see this structure, four-lobed structure that we call as a microsporangium. In each microsporangium, there is a presence in the center, there is a presence of a sporogenous tissue. Each sporogenous tissue behaves as a pollen mother cell. Each pollen mother cell divide by meiosis give the microspore tetrades. Each tetrade behave as a microspore, uninucleate microspores, right? And these uninucleate microspores start developing and reaches to where? Reaches to the female gametophyte, right? So development of the microspore from the pollen mother cell, that is known as a microsporogenesis. Now, what is there? After microspore, they start developing into gametes. Means what happens actually? So now you can see in this, this is what, this is a microspore. Means this is what, this is a vegetative cell and this is a generative cell, right? Vegetative cell, generative cell start dividing, and by the meiosis second, they give what? They give the two male gametes. This is, you can see here, two sperm cells. So this we call as a two male gamete. So this we call as a three cell stage. I have told you earlier also. So each microspore, when they shed off from the anther, that time they are two cell stages, means they are having a generative cell and a vegetative cell. But while they reach to the tip of the carpel, or you can say on the stigma, that time there is a formation of a another cell by the division of a generative cell and formation of a two sperm cell. So that time pollen grains are three cell stages. One is known as a vegetative and two is known as a male gamete. So they will reach to where? They will reach to the stigma of the carpel by the process that we call as a pollination. So this all about what? This all about the development of the male gametophyte. In the next video, we will see the development of the female gametophyte. And I hope you will go through this thoroughly. If you will get any problem or any confusion, you are free to ask me. We will discuss in the coming session. Thank you.